Hi. Thanks so much. It's great to be here out in the real America. as the real America of Chilmark. Actually, this is my first reading or talk outside of Washington. And the first thing you should know about me, and I would say 99.9% of all journalists, is that speeches don't come naturally. I much prefer an interactive format, so I will keep my remarks brief. I'll probably read a few passages. Then I would love to welcome your questions and welcome this being as much of a conversation as possible. But what's great about being outside of Washington, finally, is that one thing you realize, one, when you write a book like this, two, when you live there and sort of cover these people, but also three, when you write a book about this world and then sort of roll it out, is that it takes on a life of its own, and people do tend to focus on the Washington things about it, i.e., how do I come off? What is this? How does this reflect on me? How does this reflect on my friends? How does this reflect on my enemies? And then when the book comes out, they focus on the nuggets. Who wins? Who loses? What are the embarrassing little tidbits? What are the great little one-liners? I mean, it's all very shorthand. And the other thing about a book like this is there was all this odd anticipation and speculation about it to a point where it's been out for almost 3 weeks. It came out July 16th, but a copy of this turned up in the Newark airport 2 weeks earlier. And I guess this was a book where if a copy of it turns up 2 weeks early in the Newark airport and a reporter finds it, it becomes news. So the reporter bought a copy, suddenly little tidbits started coming out via Twitter, and then all this weird hysteria broke loose, and I couldn't really talk about it because the book hadn't come out yet. And since then, it's just taken on this reality distortion field in Washington, and this is why it's so good to actually talk to people outside of town. And I have noticed, and this has been very gratifying, that the farther away from Washington you get, whether it's in the form of emails, whether it's a form of interviews with people in other parts of the country, whether it's people who don't live in Washington, whether it's people who are in Washington but who have a level of self-awareness about what is really going on in Washington, it has been very satisfying to see what I think has been a really great mix of both, I guess, entertainment but also outrage about the world that has grown up in Washington over many, many years, but especially in this century. And what I wanted to do with this book is essentially profile a city in the moment. And this is our capital city, Washington, D.C., and the moment is the 21st century. And it's a time in which Washington and politics has been given over to an unprecedented degree by money. It's been changed by new media, arguably more than any other city in the country. I didn't know if the microphone wasn't working. See, this is speeches. Doesn't come natural. And what I wanted to do, I think, is essentially chart the life of this dramatically changed city, the most powerful city in the country, the most reviled city in the country, the most disappointing city in the country, the most momentous city in the country, perhaps, over a five-year period. So I started charting a bunch of characters, a bunch of institutions, over a period beginning in June of 2008, beginning with the death of Tim Russert, which was this incredible pageant in which a lot of my characters are introduced. And here you had this giant of a newsman who lived very much at the nexus of politics and media and money, who was the man no one would mess with. Meet the Press was really the center of the conversation. If you wanted to be taken seriously as a Senate candidate or a presidential candidate, you had to go through Tim Russert's chair. Tim's loss, which came suddenly, occurred at the dawn of this presidential campaign, which would result in this change election, the middle of three change elections, 2006, 2008, 2010. You had the Obama change brigades coming into town. You had these people vowing to change Washington, as everybody does. But there seemed to be some great and added hope and obviously historic weight behind this new president. The economy was about to collapse. The Washington economy barely hiccuped, if at all. It only continued to get more bountiful, and more money kept pouring into politics and the city itself. And I just sort of jumped off from there. And I wrote about just the whole carnival that Washington has become. And there are some broad themes about how this city built on public service has been given over increasingly to self-service, about how Washington appears to be so divided from the outside if you go by the shouting matches you see on cable or the things not getting done in Congress or the trivialities of the debate you see having in Congress or the hysteria on the blogs. But in fact, it's a city that's hopelessly interconnected in which Democrats and Republicans are in fact doing very, very well. A lot of Democrats and Republicans are actually going into business together. They're doing sort of dog and pony show shouting matches on TV, on the book circuit, on the speaking circuit. And it has, I wanted to sort of chart the disconnect between the gilded capital and a country that is struggling mightily, but also feeling very, very badly about its capital city. So I guess in that vein, I'm going to, the last time I read, which was in Washington, D.C. at Politics and Prose, which is probably the foremost bookstore in Washington, D.C., and it's the belly of the beast, according to the person who introduced me in Politics and Prose. I wanted to just read a couple of smaller profiles in here of people who I think are unusual for this book. I mean, they're unusual in that some of the people who have responded to them have said that, wow, I learned a lot about Harry Reid, who's one of them, and Tom Coburn, who's his opposite. This is Coburn is a conservative Republican senator from Oklahoma. Harry Reid is a Senate Majority Leader Democrat. These two men despise each other. Harry Reid is the ultimate institutionalist, ultimate sort of political survivor. Tom Coburn has been called by some the father of the Tea Party. He's been called Dr. No. These are two people who have absolutely no interest in the Washington game. And I wanted to read some brief portions of Chapter 3, which is called Three Senators for Our Time. The third senator is Trent Lott, but you can read about him if you buy the book. And then I'll take your questions, because I much prefer answering questions to speaking and reading. So this is a short piece about Harry Reid, and the book follows a five-year chronology. In 2009 was this year. The health care bill was going through very, very slowly, Senate and Congress. The stimulus bill, it was just Obama's first year here, and Harry Reid was very much, as I call him, the beleaguered face of change. Entrusted with a Senate supermajority and endowed with all the magnetism of a dried snail, Harry Reid owned the beleaguered face of change in 2009. But the opening scene, at least mine, because I was in the room, played out a few years before, on election night 2006, the night Democrats regained control of the House and Senate for the first time since 1994. Reid, then the Senate Minority Leader, and Chuck Schumer, who had run the Democrats' Senate Campaign Committee, were watching returns in a suite at the Hyatt Regency Washington on Capitol Hill. The Felix and Oscar pair, Reid, a hush-voiced Mormon from Searchlight, Nevada, and Schumer, a bombastic Jew from Brooklyn, was becoming more and more silly as the night wore on. At one point, Schumer, whose chin was smeared with mustard in two distinct splotches, exploded off the couch. CNN was calling the close Missouri Senate race for Democrat Claire McCaskill. "Yeah," Schumer grunted out through his food, holding two fists over his head. Reid, a man of thoroughgoing cynicism, is nonetheless capable of boyish hullabaloo at times like this. So what did Harry Reid do to mark this key step in his ascent to Senate Majority Leader? He rose from the couch and he kissed the television, tenderly caressing the screen, and then he sat back down to receive from Schumer something between a pat on the head and a noogie. Reid then started placing congratulatory calls to the Democrats who had won. None of the calls exceeded 30 seconds, and each was punctuated by a variant of, "I love you." Reid professed his love for Senator Ken Conrad, who was reelected in South Dakota. "Love you, man." Sherrod Brown in Ohio, and Hillary Clinton in New York, who told Reid that she loved him back. I was standing a few feet away from the couch, sanctioned that night by Reid and Schumer to be a fly on the wall, a journalistic practice that is both a cliche and a misnomer. Nobody notices the actual fly on the wall while everyone is fully mindful of the maggot reporter taking notes. But these moments can be revealing, especially in the midst of such punch-drunk victories. Reid must have detected my amusement at the I love yous, which he explained to me matter-of-factly. "They need to hear that," he said. They are political people, and Reed, their leader, a former Nevada gaming commissioner, parcels out love like casino chips. Whether it is real love or pseudo-love doesn't quite matter. Love is gold currency in the rolling transaction of politics, a game played by the nation's most ambitious and insecure class. In his stooped and unassuming and easy-to-miss way, no one understands this better than Harry Mason Reed. A few months later, Reed showed up on the Senate floor to hear John Kerry announce that he would not run for president again in 2008. It was a difficult moment for Kerry, the 2004 Democratic nominee, who was now shedding an ambition he appeared to have held since kindergarten. Just before the 2006 midterms, Kerry had acquired a nasty case of political cooties after attempting a laugh line about the war in Iraq, never a good idea, which many construed as a knock against U.S. soldiers. Now Kerry was making his heavy announcement to a near-empty chamber that included only Reed and fellow Massachusetts Senator Ted Kennedy. After Kerry finished, Reed, who was standing next to him, gave Kerry a big hug and said a few words for the record. "He is one of those people who meant so much to me," Reed said of Kerry, belying the scorn he had expressed to others for the lanky Bay State senator for many years. Reed had observed privately, for instance, to colleagues that Kerry had no friends. No matter, Reed was John Kerry's friend today, publicly, and it felt nothing but sincere. "So I say to John Kerry," Reed concluded, "I love you, John Kerry." Kerry nodded slowly and appeared to choke back tears. That's a brief Harry Reid reading, and is a little Coburn reading. It actually, both of these readings go to the larger sort of psychological insight and cynicism that both of these men, in their own very distinct and, again, they despise each other kind of way, have, and also in a weird way, a kind of lack of respect they have for their colleagues. But it's neither here nor there. And this is later in 2009. So again, the book goes along chronology, so this is later in the chapter, and we're later in 2009. "In October in 2009, as the health care bill was heading to the Senate floor, I visited Coburn at his home in Muskogee, Oklahoma, about an hour southeast of Tulsa. Armadillos keep trying to tear up his lawn. He keeps pulling fat water moccasins out of his swimming pool. I kill them," Coburn says with relish, "by slicing their heads off with the sharp edge of a shovel." He planned to do the same to the health care bill. "Enacting the legislation would be catastrophic," Coburn said, and he was determined to gum up the process. "My mission is to frame this health care debate in terms of the fiscal ruin of this country," said Coburn, who had a few days earlier railed on the Senate floor that the federal debt was, quote, waterboarding his five grandchildren. As he stood in the driveway of his seven-acre estate, Coburn kept looking back on the ground behind him, distracted. One of the two dogs, the skinnier one, Bo, had a terrible case of eczema on his belly. Bo kept rolling onto his back, exposing a raw, hairless patch of the afflicted area. He kept whimpering, begging for scratches, until Coburn finally obliged. The dog squeaked with delight, and the senator wheeled around with a point to make. "See, that's what it's that's what the average politician is like. They all need to have their bellies scratched. It's all about the strokes." Before I left Coburn's house, the senator described for me the Zen state he would achieve when mowing his lawn. Coburn then invited me to take a spin on his prized John Deere tractor, which I did, and it did not end well. That's to say, in a collision with the side of his barn. Parenthetical, there's obviously a larger lesson to draw here about city Jews not meant for tractors, but that would be stereotyping, which we would never do. Back in his Senate office, Coburn became most animated on the subject of political psychology. His next book, he says, will be on the power of anxiety, worry, and fear in Washington. Those emotions lead politicians to cling to the safest, most conventional methods of staying in power. In contemporary Washington, he says, this is the easiest way to remain in office, to embrace a rigid partisanship. This, he says, usually signals a deeper faith in careerism than in conservatism or liberalism. I very much agree with that last point about the culture of careerism, self-perpetuation among those in our ruling class, whether they're elected, formers, people lobbying, people looking for their next job, and so forth. So anyway, I can read all day, but I'd rather not. I'd much rather take your questions. So from there, why don't we jump off? So.
I have a question. I understand you touch on our Democratic candidate for governor in Virginia, Terry McAuliffe, in your book.
Yeah.
I know, and I understand another friend of his is mentioned without by name. But anyway, could you shed some light in view of what came out in the New York Times this morning about Mr. McAuliffe and Mr. Cuccinelli and the race, and even though it's in Virginia, it's right outside of Washington, and I'm sure.
Sure.
And also our problems vis-a-vis the problems with the current governor.
Yeah, McDonald. Yeah, no. Well, okay, this is a terrible confession to make. I haven't gotten through the entire New York Times yet today, so I haven't. Oh, okay. Well, I mean, basically, you have Terry McAuliffe, the former Democratic National Committee chairman, and Ken Cuccinelli, who's the Attorney General of Virginia. Very conservative, Cuccinelli. McAuliffe, I mean, as much of a party animal, meaning political party animal, party animal, in all senses of the word, is a classic character. I mean, Terry McAuliffe is a recurring part of this book, and one of the interesting things about it was I was dying to sort of spend some time with Terry McAuliffe, whom, like anyone in politics, I've come up against or known for years. And he is now running as an outsider. He is someone who has... Well, no, he claims he's an outsider now. He's an entrepreneur. He would much rather be in Roanoke and much rather be in Richmond, yeah, than in Washington, even though he's lived there his entire life. Yes. No. He has nothing to do with Washington anymore. Terry McAuliffe is a classic example of someone who came up very much in the political class. I mean, the political class in Washington, which is a loose assembly of, again, elected officials, staff people, party people, campaign officials, celebrity operatives, the kind of which you see on TV 24 hours a day, the likes of which didn't really exist on TV 30 years ago because there just wasn't the appetite or the platforms for them, who just by nature of being a professional party operative, a fundraiser in his case, but eventually the Democratic National Committee chair, has become a brand of himself, and he is dying to transition into someone who actually makes the decisions. One of the things I like about Terry McAuliffe is that he's fairly unabashed about who he is. He says some fairly outrageous things, as I chronicle in here. He is, you know, he's trying to reinvent himself on the fly, which is what politics is. People reinventing themselves, at least for the purposes of selling a version of themselves that they think can be elected. And I guess in a weird way, I have a grudging respect for him because he's more transparent about it than others. He doesn't shroud it in the same level of sanctimony than others do. But it's a fascinating race. I guess he's ahead a few points in the polls, but it's... I've got to go back and read that. Sorry. I'll be better prepared next time.
You hear that the environment in Washington is much worse than it's ever been, and it's more toxic, and nothing can get done. I just wonder if you think that's true, and if so, why?
Yeah, I mean, I think the notion of nostalgia here is always very dangerous. I don't want to be one of these people who says, well, it was so much better in Nixon's day, back before we had cable and back before we had blogs and stuff. No, I think, look, there has always been a level of pathology in Washington. It has always been a machine that lends itself to opportunism, to vanity, to, I think, a lot of the same, a lot of the less noble virtues that we see, again, on cable 24 hours a day. I think what's been notable about the last maybe decade and a half has been the influx of money. The fact that you have, and this is a Tom Coburn term, a permanent feudal class of the political world that just has settled in Washington, has gotten extremely wealthy in Washington. There's a maxim now that there's no such thing as Democrats and Republicans in Washington, only millionaires. And people didn't 30, 40 years ago come to Washington to get rich. That just was not, if you did, you never talked about it. It is now a gold rush environment with far more in common than Wall Street, Vegas, Hollywood, than you would ever think. And so that's one. And I also think new media, just the idea that anyone can build a brand for themselves, anyone can tweet their way to a certain cheap kind of Washington fame, or any strategist, or anyone can call themselves a strategist, get on TV and just like talk about tax reform or immigration without knowing the first thing about it. I mean, it's really the easiest thing in the world. I mean, actually, this is a dirty little secret. I was on, in promoting this book, I've had to do a lot of TV, and I love it because it's mostly people asking me questions about the book. But occasionally they'll say, hey, can you stick around for the panel? And I'm like, I don't want to stick around for the panel. But then you're in this green room and they're just like, well, we're sort of expecting you. So, all right, so what are we going to talk about? And they give you a list of, okay, the economy, voter, I mean, just like things that are that they're talking about that day. And you just wing it. It's easy. If you read the paper, you can just like throw a few things together. But it's not edifying for anyone. I mean, and so, I don't know. I think the city has changed fundamentally over the last decade and a half, and I wanted to sort of bring that to life. So,
I'm interested by the fact that you're discussing the culture of careerism and sort of the get-rich-quick nature of Washington. When the previous speaker spoke about, you know, so many of the changes in the world and how the nature of power is changing, on how that has the potential for a lot of good, but something that hasn't changed much recently is politics and the nature of politics. Can you draw a comparison or at least comment on that?
Well, I think, look, I mean, these are in a way, certainly information-wise, revolutionary times. I mean, I think one of the misconceptions about new media and the internet and you know, just the media environment we have now is that, well, it's just so completely democratizing. It has, now everyone is on equal footing. But I think, in fact, new media has created, you know, again, a sort of anarchy, but it's also, I think, just exacerbated a lot of the same vanities and opportunisms that has always existed in D.C. But look, I think the power of new media is real and it's here to stay. I mean, if you look at certainly its role in revolutions and in Iran and just uprising across the country. And so, yeah, I just think it's, I think right now, Washington is an extremely change-averse environment. I think, again, the local economy is very much set up to benefit by the failings of people working on behalf of the American people. For instance, if a tax reform bill passes tomorrow, that will be billions of dollars of unrealized consulting fees and lobbying fees and cable shouting matches and what have you. I mean, it is a city that thrives on its own failure. And again, I mean, that in a very perverse way is a good form of its own careerism, right? I mean, you can reinvent yourself very, very easily. So I think, look, I mean, I think Washington is not, as much of it can seem like, it's not a bubble. I think it will go kicking and screaming along to what is in the self-interest of people inside to do, and I think new media can do that. But no, I think one of the things I tried to capture here is this collision of great tumult and change with great stagnation, great inertia, and great sort of clinging to the status quo of people's own power bases in D.C.
I would love to read your book, and will. You know, 20% of the people think Congress is doing a good job. 45% think Obama's doing a good job. There's cynicism and lack of trust in Washington. Do you see any solution, anything to get any upside, or are we looking at the fall and decline of the Roman Empire?
Well, Fareed Zakaria wrote a column a couple days ago saying that generations from now, if people look back and chart the fall and decline of this empire, they should read this book and they'll see why. So I don't know. I mean, what I don't do, and I don't know if I've been criticized for it, I guess I've been criticized for it, but I've been criticized for a lot of things. I don't have the chapter at the end that lays out the 10 bullet points on how to make Washington work better. I mean, I'm not going to say we need term limits, we need a third party, we need sweeping campaign finance reform. I mean, I'm not a solutions guy. I'm a journalist, and part of what I do is just try to hold a mirror to the world I'm writing about and the culture I'm writing about. So I guess speaking in my own experience, I mean, living in Washington and getting to know a lot of these people up close, I would make sort of a lame generalization, which is that neither party has a monopoly on character, on good ideas, on good people. I mean, it sounds very contradictory to some of the themes of the book, but I like a lot of people in Washington. I think a lot of people work extremely hard. I think there's some incredibly smart people there. And a lot of people have asked me, who do you like the best in the book? Or who comes off worse in the book? Or who should be run out of town? And essentially I'm trying to focus. I want this to be a profile of a city. I want it to be a profile of a machine, of a system, and how that system can sort of rub off on people and how it can create people and create types and reward types. But I hope someone comes up with solutions, because it really, and by the way, I think you're optimistic on the 20% approval for Congress. I think it's maybe about, it might be in single digits last time I saw it. I mean, the question is, do people disapprove of their own member of Congress? I mean, will they, I mean, if you usually say, well, how would you rate Congress? Say, oh, Congress is terrible. How would you rate your congressperson? Oh, I kind of like, oh, I think I'll vote for him. You know, I've been voting for him for years. So one of the many contradictions.
Thank you.
Sure.
Hi. Do you think any of the current dysfunction in Congress relates to the race of our president, the fact that we have this African-American president?
Maybe. I really don't know. I mean, I think race is an extremely powerful issue. I think it's one that the country is obviously going to be grappling with for a long time and has for a long time. I think I will say generally that the vilification machine in American politics did not begin with President Obama. I mean, I think that...
Has it turned it up because of...
Maybe. I mean, look, it's certainly possible. It's certainly been speculated on. I think it's added a level of charge to a lot of how people see this presidency and how people have seen his engagement. But look, I mean... I will say I think President Bush was vilified to a great degree. I think President Clinton was vilified to a great degree. I mean, I think the modern presidency, I mean, one of the things I've heard about this book is, you know, President Obama is somewhat absent from the book. And I think his change brigades, a lot of the people around him who became these celebrity operatives who have sort of taken the revolving door are much more prominent in this book. But the modern presidency is very hard for me to get my head around. It is a job that is so big and so superhuman and lends itself to a level of scrutiny and self-assurance, but I don't know how you live in such an isolated place, but also in a place where you are being scrutinized to that degree. I don't know. I mean, in a way, I kind of punt on the presidency because I don't get it. I will never... I don't think I'm ever going to be elected president or be close friends with anyone who's elected or related to it. But I don't know. How's that for an answer?
You seem to have violated one of the basic principles of journalists in Washington, which is don't blow away your sources. Over the years, one has been very proud and honored by our journalists in Washington, but one of the things they're very careful about is not being so critical of individuals and of the system that they can't continue to work there. You talk a lot about careerism, are you afraid that this book might have damaged your careerism instincts?
My careerism instincts. I would say this. Very important distinction, okay? The notion of burning sources, okay, which is a term some have used. I don't burn sources. I mean, as journalists, you enter into ground rules, agreements, relationships of mutual trust, and you don't violate them under any circumstances. Right. You adhere to a certain set of guidelines about not wanting to surprise someone. You do everything you possibly can to be right. I mean, believe me, I mean, it's 110,000 words. I agonized over every page. A lot can go wrong in 110,000 words. And I think a lot of my favorite reporters, are neurotic. And I worry about all of that stuff. I also worry about the line between critical, acerbic, and mean. Try very hard not to get into mean. Probably fail on some occasions, but do. But I would say the criticism I have gotten has not been on individual facts or individual, how dare you do that to so-and-so. It has been a much broader, how dare you violate the unspoken code of someone inside the club speaking critically of other people inside the club. I have had absolutely no problem talking to people in the 3-4 weeks since this book's been out. I've had people quibbling, which is, you know, you're going to get no matter what, but I feel very good about how I'll be able to move forward on this. And I think, look, if I'm sure it's going to hurt some feelings. I know it's hurt some feelings, but that's fine. I think that's part of being a reporter.
Have you called up Senator Reid yet?
He called me.
Oh, really?
Yeah, no. He called me a couple weeks ago. He said, really enjoyed your book. Senator Reid has these really quick phone conversations where he never hangs up, or he never says goodbye before he hangs up. They almost never exceed 20 seconds. These I love you ones were kind of interesting because he would end with I love you. But no, he said, I love that chapter. I love chapter 8. That was my favorite one. And I said, you're not mad at me, are you, Senator? He goes, if I were mad at you, you'd know it. Click. So yeah, he called. And no, it's fine.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
So in the mid-1800s, de Tocqueville said America was a country of very, very, very ambitious people with very low ambitions. It sounds like you've just profiled our Congress. My question is, among the universe of people who are only interested in their next job, have you found any dormant FDRs or others who can think more largely about the big picture, can actually think about making good things happen?
Yeah, I like to think so. I mean, I don't know. There are a lot of idealists in D.C. I mean, I think a lot of them get demoralized. A lot of them sort of get sort of washed away in the larger sort of careerism that we're talking about. But yeah, look, I think the American public, and again, it's important to kind of get outside of Washington here, has an incredible appetite for something authentic, something that can actually give us something different. I think Barack Obama is an example of that in 2008. I think he's also an example of the limits of that through his presidency. I think things like the Tea Party, it's very easy to turn your nose up at, you know, Herman Cain or Sarah Palin or people on left or right. But, I mean, I think this comes from something. I mean, the appeal of these people, this is not just something you can sort of throw away to, well, there's always going to be a populist segment of the U.S. population. But I think there is an incredibly real appetite for some kind of straight talk, some kind of blowing this thing up. I don't know how you get there, but I think that the right kind of maybe third-party candidate, maybe insurgent candidate could possibly get us closer. But I don't know. But, no, there are some very smart and committed people in D.C. So, yeah.
Thank you for your talk. I vaguely remember reading in a book in the 1990s, it may have been called The History of Democracy, I'm not 100% sure, mm-hmm. but the author talked about the rules changes that occurred in Congress in the late 60s, early 70s, as a result of the 1960s
right.
and all, where things went from the back room to being more transparent.
Mm-hmm.
And he talked about how difficult it can be to operate in a transparent world. And I'm wondering if, no matter how good a person is when he's elected to go to Washington, the rules are just so much, the rules of Congress and the way they operate are just so much against them that it makes it almost impossible for anyone to do a good job.
Maybe. I think... yeah, I mean, I have a hard time sort of saying that the needs of transparency are the reason that nothing is getting done in Congress. I mean, my bias is always going to be towards transparency as a journalist, but I think that you're right, though. I mean, the broader thing of rule changes, certainly on the gerrymandering of districts, certainly in what is rewarded. I mean, I think you now live in a system, and again, speaking from our profession, where punditry is very, very, is a gold standard as opposed to... you know, reporting in the journalism industry, but also in Congress. I mean, if you're a backbencher, you're probably not going to get your name on a big bill. You're probably not going to get like a big high-profile speaking gig. But if you yell loud enough, you can get on Fox or MSNBC. Anyone can run for president. I mean, Michelle Bachmann didn't achieve a heck of a lot in Congress, and she ran for president, and she got on cable a lot, and I'm sure she will have great speaking fees and might maybe her own cable show. So, again, I mean, it all sort of, I mean, yes, I mean, rule changes have made things, I think most of them probably have been for the better, not all of them, there have been a lot of unintended consequences. But again, the system is very much rigged to not getting things done. So, yeah. Hi.
I have a friend who purported to have been the Romney administration's next candidate for ambassador to the Court of St. James based on the amount of contributions and bundling he had done.
Right.
There may be several other people here who also had that expectation, but I don't know.
Right.
He had gone to Boston the night before the election, ostensibly as part of this gathering of contributors who were going to celebrate Romney's victory.
Right.
What he told me he was really expecting to do was to participate in a conference the next day of the Koch brothers and other hedge fund people and financiers who were planning on running an advertising campaign because the expectation of the campaign was that they were going to win the popular vote and lose the electoral vote. And because of the 2000 precedent, the Republican Party itself couldn't claim, well, it's anti-democratic to have the electoral vote winner not be the popular vote winner. So they were going to start this huge citizens campaign to demand that electors change their votes and select the popular vote victor. And what that makes me think about is this continuing strength of the Tea Party and the folks who have portrayed themselves as the original Tea Party people who are working with Dick Armey tend to be non-moneyed, simple folk. Do you find in Washington that on the political level and on the lobbying level, the institutional level, that there is a bona fide Tea Party movement, or is it really a front for the same large, you know, mega moneyed interests that are, you know, because of the Citizens Union case, are really trying to
Citizens United case? No, I think it's both. Yeah, I mean, look, you're gonna but this the grassroots movements of the Tea Party or the Occupy movement or what swept President Obama in. I mean, that's all real. I mean, that's there's a lot of people behind that, and yes, there's a lot of money behind it, and I mean, a lot of it is made up of the fronts that you might be talking about, but. I mean, I think, first of all, both sides were preparing for some kind of lawyer hang-up or electoral split. I mean, there was, both sides had, lawyers in Florida. I mean, both sides make all kinds of just provisions for in case of some kind of deadlock like that. But, I mean, I think the larger sort of matter-of-factness of, he was expecting to be ambassador to the Court of St. James. I mean, Terry McAuliffe, the aforementioned Terry McAuliffe, was also fully expecting to be ambassador to the Court of St. James when Bill Clinton was elected, or was about to leave office in 2000. And then President Clinton said to Terry McAuliffe, so, what do you want as a reward for raising all this money for me? But he said that in so many words, and McAuliffe said, oh, I want to be ambassador to the Great Britain. So, that's what the Court of St. James is. So he said, okay. And so he was about to do it, and President Clinton got on the phone to Trent Lott, who was then the Senate Majority Leader, and said, hey, can you help me out with Terry? I mean, I want to sort of get him. I want him to get this ambassadorship. He's been really good and well for me. And Trent Lott said, sure. And I guess Trent Lott's reasoning was, yeah, we'll get the biggest Democratic fundraiser out of the country in time for the 2000 election. But I remember reading that, and Terry McAuliffe actually told me this story, and it turns out he didn't take the job because Al Gore begged him to take over the finances of the Democratic Convention in Los Angeles that year, which was going bankrupt, and he said, okay. But I just remember thinking, okay, so that's sort of how it works. I mean, obviously ambassadorships are plums. It's been true for many, many decades, but I mean, you would think that, like, being an ambassador to the Court of St. James or Japan or any big country, I mean, would take some kind of foreign service skill or something like that. I don't know. I mean, I think that I always find that sort of funny that, well, so-and-so was going to be named and I don't know. But I don't know. I think, look, it's a mixture. I think a lot of people in D.C. try to leverage what they perceive to be grassroots movements as their own. I think that that's been true certainly on the right. I think it's been true on the left also.
Thank you so much.
We good? So, thanks.